some coffee and sit in a comfy chair and read a little bit with reading glasses, which I don't have. But that's okay, because I'm going to make it through. The very, very first part of this book I found very interesting. And this was like 2 days ago. And I thought, maybe I should read it. It may be a bit deep for early morning, but I believe in you. So I want to read a little bit of this to you, and then let's talk about it, okay? And I love the title of this chapter, this very first chapter. You ready? It's called The Insufficiency of Everything Attainable. Let that one sink in for a minute. The insufficiency of everything attainable. Ready? Booty bag. This is a quote. In the torment of the insufficiency of everything attainable, we come to understand that here, in this life, all symphonies remain unfinished. Carl Rayner wrote these words. Not to understand them is to risk letting restlessness become a cancer in our lives. What does it mean to be tormented by the insufficiency of everything attainable? How are we tortured by what we cannot have? We all experience this daily. In fact, for all but a few privileged, peaceful times, this torment is like an undertow to everything we experience. Beauty makes us restless when it should give us peace. The love we experience with our spouse does not fulfill our longings. The relationships we have with our families seem sometimes too petty and domestic to be fulfilling. Our job is hopelessly inadequate to the dreams we had for ourselves. The place we live seems boring and lifeless in comparison to other places. And we are too restless to sit peacefully at our own tables, sleep peacefully in our own beds, and be at ease within our own skins. We are tormented by the insufficiency of everything attainable when our lives are too small for us and we live them in such a way that we are always waiting for something or somebody to come along and change things so that our real lives, as we imagine them, will begin. I remember a story a man once shared with me on a retreat. He was 45 years old, had a good marriage, was a father, many of three healthy children, had a secure, if unexciting, job, and lived in a peaceful, if equally unexciting, neighborhood. Yet, to use his words, he was not fully inside his own life. This was his confession. Quote, "For most of my life, and especially for the past 20 years, I have been too restless to really live my own life. I've never really accepted what I am. A 45-year-old man working in a grocery store in a small town, married to a good, if unexciting, woman, aware that my marriage will never fulfill my deep sexual yearnings, and aware, despite all of my daydreaming and autographs of some famous people that I've been collecting, I am not going anywhere. I will never fulfill my dreams. I will only be here as I am now, in this small town, in this particular marriage with these people, in this body for the rest of my life. I will only grow fatter, balder, and physically less healthy and attractive. But what is sad in all this is that from every indication, I should be having a good life. I am lucky, really. I'm healthy, loved, secure, in a good marriage, living in a country of peace and plenty, yet inside myself, I am so restless that I never enjoy my own life and my wife and my kids and my job and the place that I live. I am always at some other place inside myself, too restless to really be where I am at, too restless to live in my own house, too restless to really be inside my own skin. That is what the torment of the insufficiency of everything attainable feels like in actual life. But Rainer's insight is more than merely diagnostic. It is prescriptive too. It points out how we are to move beyond that torment, beyond the cancer of restlessness. How? By beginning to understand that here, in this life, all symphonies remain unfinished. The reason why we are tormented is not, first of all, because we are oversexed, hopelessly neurotic, ungrateful persons who are too greedy to be satisfied with this life. The first and deep reason, here comes. The first and deep reason is that we are congenitally overcharged and overbuilt for this earth. Infinite spirits living in a finite situation. Hearts made for union with everything and everybody, meeting only mortal persons and things. Small wonder we have problems with insatiability, daydreams, loneliness, and restlessness. We are grand canyons without a bottom. Nothing short of union with all that is can ever fill in that void. To be tormented by restlessness is to be human. But in accepting truly that humanity, we become more easy in our restlessness by accepting that humanity. Why? Because as Rainer puts it, in this life, there is no finished symphony. Everything comes with an undertow of restlessness and inadequacy. This is true of everyone. As Henry Nguyen says, here in this world, there is no such thing as a clear-cut, pure joy. Peace and restlessness can come to us only when we accept that fact, because it is only then that we will stop demanding that life, our spouses, our families, our friends, our jobs, our vacations, our vocations, give us something they cannot give, namely a finished symphony. Clear-cut, pure joy, complete consummation. Kind of heavy, right? Is it heavy? Are you with me, though? Are you tracking what it's saying? All life is fired by longing. The simplest of plants and the highest of human love have this in common: yearning, restlessness, a certain insatiable pressure to eat, to grow, to breed, to push beyond one's self. Yet longing is something that is rarely examined, despite the fact that it lies at the very heart of the soul. What is longing? What does it mean to yearn? What is the insatiable press inside us to eat, to drink, to want to be outside our own skins, and to want to make ourselves immortal? Mostly it is unconscious, a dark, relentless pressure to reach beyond ourselves. We see this pressure even in plants. A friend of mine shares how after buying a house, he decided to get rid of a bamboo plant in his driveway. Somebody knows where this is going. He cut the plant down, took an axe, and chopped down deep into the earth, destroying as much of the roots as he could. Then he poured bluestone, a plant poison, on what remained, Finally, he filled the hole where the plant had been with several feet of gravel, which he then tapped tightly and then paved over with cement. 2 years later, the cement heaved as that bamboo plant began to slowly push its way through the pavement. Its life principle, the blind pressure to grow, was not easily thwarted by axes, poison, and cement. That's awesome. There is an insatiable power, a blind pressure to grow in all living things. If you put a 2-inch band of solid steel around a young watermelon, it will, as it grows, slowly burst that steel. I'm going to stop there because I want to talk about how I want to tie that in to what I want to share with you. Give me that back. There's something further ahead that I want to share. This is what I want to share with you. If we're honest with ourselves, and I hope that as I was reading that, you are kind of taking an inventory in your own life and thinking, do I feel that way? Do I think like that? If you're open, and I will admit to you, I feel that way. There is a reason for that. And the reason is that we were not created. This is my belief, by the way. Let me preface this by saying, this is what I believe. I'm not demanding you believe anything or you accept anything. I'm sharing what I believe. And you let it, you just stay on it and you decide if it resonates with you. Okay? I believe that within every one of you, within all of us, God has placed his own spirit. I believe that there is a bit of eternity in all of us. I believe we were not created to just be born, grow, and die on this planet. I believe there is more to you and more to me and more to her and more to him than can be quantified by anything in the material world. It cannot be measured, it cannot be weighed, it cannot be seen or touched, but I believe it is most certainly there. And this is one of the reasons you know. Because nothing completely, totally, forever satisfies within this world. And it's not supposed to. That's the point. You were created, I was created for more than the accumulation of stuff in this world. It touched on it at the very end where it talked about complete union with everything. And that is, at its core, union with God. With our Creator, as it was always intended. And as long as you or I spend our lives trying to accumulate as much stuff and wealth and power and influence and money, the list goes on. The accumulation of all things attainable, as long as we spend our lives trying to fill a hole that will not be filled with anything else but a relationship with our Creator, we will forever be unsatisfied, forever restless, incomplete, and not even know why. You guys know who C.S. Lewis is? You know that he wrote Language and Wardrobe, a lot of amazing books. Did you know he was a Christian? Yes. Very, very strong, very deep thinking, believer. And I'm pretty certain he is credited with saying there is a God-shaped hole in all of us. Now, I want you to picture that. Get a visual image. Anybody ever make jigsaw puzzles? Dang, I hate jigsaw puzzles. I am so impatient, I can't stand them. I'll like try to put two pieces together. This is stupid. 3 minutes, I'm done. There's a table in Funimation with jigsaw puzzles on it for the actors, like while they're waiting to be called into the studio. There's a coffee table with a jigsaw puzzle. And every time I'm there, I'll go in and I'll go sit down and I'll see that puzzle and be like, I won't even try. And as soon as somebody finishes it, they turn it over and mix it up and start it going. So you find this piece of the jigsaw puzzle you're working on, and you think it fits in this hole, and it doesn't. It looks like it does, but it doesn't. You ever been there? And you try to jam it, right? But it won't fit because it ain't the right piece. Eventually, you have to admit that, right? You have to admit to yourself it's not the right piece. It's the same way with this God-shaped hole. Go ahead, try to fill it with anything you want. Try to push it in there as much as you want. It's not going to fit. The insufficiency of everything attainable, it doesn't work. I get so sad every time I happen to be scrolling through channels looking for something, and there will be one of these behind the music documentaries or a celebrity documentary about some famous person who killed themselves. And there's a common thread through it all. I don't know if you've ever noticed it. And here's the common thread. They got everything the world told them you should have to be happy. Did you guys ever contemplate that when you watched any of these documentaries about famous people that committed suicide? You're like, how is that possible? They were rich. They were famous. They were loved by the world. People adored them. They were movie stars. They were rock stars. They had all this musical talent, and they created beautiful songs, and they acted on the big screen, and people loved them, and they had big mansions and lots of cars. And they killed themselves. Why? Did you ever ask that? The insufficiency of everything attainable. Do you see it? Can you imagine the utter hopelessness of getting everything there is to get and still being unsatisfied? Now, you and I, we probably don't have that problem. You know what I mean? Like, we don't have the problem of having $100 million in the bank, right? And we can't decide if we want to drive the Ferrari or the Lamborghini today, right? And do we want to spend the weekend at our summer home in Catalina, or do we want to spend, right? We don't have that problem. But here's what I'm saying to you. I hope you're hearing me. If you had all of that, it still wouldn't matter. You're still you. And those things will not satisfy the longing in you. The perfect boy will never satisfy that. The perfect, most beautiful girl will never satisfy that. The best job, your dream job, will for about 3 weeks maybe, but ultimately it will not. And I believe the reason for that is because we were made for relationship with our Creator. And the older I get, the more I'm sure of it. And anything else will not do. What's really sad to me is that We can't seem to learn that from other people. You know what I mean? Like, you can have all the people in your life telling you, I've been there. Trust me, this is the way it is. Right? But you don't believe them. You somehow, young, right? Immortal. You think you're going to be the exception to that rule. It doesn't work. Eh, he doesn't know what he's talking about. He's old, he's sad, he didn't get what he wanted out of life. And no. It's the truth. We never seem to learn from other people's mistakes, is what I'm kind of trying to say here. We never seem to learn from the people around us who have experienced it. And they'll look you right in the face and they'll say, don't put your hand on that stove, man, it's hot. You just have to go do it, right? We can, many of us, including me, can look at our own parents. See, the choices that were made, right? The ensuing consequence of those choices, where we are today, where our family may be today, sadly, and yet end up doing the same things. I would pray in my heart that each and every one of you will think about this today or tonight as you're driving home or when your head hits your pillow tonight. I would pray that you would think about, I feel it. I hope this is you. You're laying there and you're thinking, man, I feel it. If I'm honest, deep down, I feel that. I feel that restlessness, that dissatisfaction. I'm looking for satisfaction in my job. I'm looking for satisfaction in this relationship. I'm looking for satisfaction in my bank account. I'm looking for satisfaction in the kind of clothes I wear or the kind of car I drive or any number of things. And they don't. And every time I achieve one thing, I've got to move on to the next thing because it just doesn't. It's like a fix, you know what I mean? It just doesn't do what you thought it would do for you. Or if it does, it isn't for very long. The insufficiency of everything attainable. You, my dear friends, were created for a relationship with God. Notice I didn't say Catholic God or Baptist God. Those are words people made up. You can throw them away. And I hope I don't offend anybody. There's a really good Baptist in here. He said, throw away. Yeah, because you know what? God's bigger than all that. Do you feel that? Don't you know in your heart somewhere, God's bigger than that? God can't be contained in a little building. God is so much bigger than the labels that we give him. Or the labels that we give little groups that we get together in. I'm going to go out on a limb, and I've said it before, but he is nowhere near as interested in what church you go to, or whether you even go to church, as he is that you have a relationship with him. He is nowhere near as interested that you cut your hair a certain way, and you stop watching some of that dirty anime, and get your hair back to a normal color and dress more modestly and go sit in church every Sunday and sing those songs. God's so much bigger than that, you guys. Can you step away from that for 1 minute and see how petty that is? It's so human. It's so human of us. The Bible says that man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. The way I read that is, all you can see is, all you know of me is what you see, is what you can observe with your senses, basically. And God knows you much better than that. He knows your heart. He knows your longings, your restlessness, and he's much more interested in just having a relationship with you than he is that you follow some set of rules and regulations. So, what I'd love for you to take away from this is to consider that the restlessness that we all feel, to whatever degree we feel it, or to whatever degree we're willing to acknowledge that we feel it, isn't that really what it's about? How much we're willing to just admit, yeah, it's there. I get it. Not me. Well, that's just pride. I mean, it's there. But the good news is that there is something that fills it. There is something that can give us that sense of peace and grounding that we were intended to have from the very beginning. It's not anything that anybody builds. It's not anything you can put a price tag on. It's not something you can buy in the store, not even Walmart. You and I were designed for relationship with God. I'm not asking you to go join some religion. That's another word people made up. It's just a word. People who know that people that know about my faith will come and go, yeah, I heard you're real religious. And I would say, no, I'm not. I love God. I have accepted Jesus into my heart. I believe the scripture. I'm not religious. What? I don't quite get it. Point is that there are a bunch of outward, you know, the word religion even sounds pompous to say it, right? It conjures up images in people's minds, and I can just see God going, free will. You know what I mean? I let them make their own choices. I let them do what they want. This is what happens. So I'm not interested, and I don't think you should beat yourself up about, oh yeah, I should go to church more. No, not necessarily. Church is a good thing. Church is a good thing. But have you ever heard the term putting the cart before the horse? Going to church without an open relationship with God is putting the cart before the horse. Going to church or reading a Bible or having the devotional time or praying, all of those things, or wearing certain things or making certain choices are all byproducts of a relationship. The relationship is first, and that's the most important thing. I don't know if any of you ever saw that video of the protesters. They got a lot of smarts. They read their Bible a lot. They memorized verses. But they have no relationship. Do you see it? The relationship is missing. And because the relationship is missing, there's no compassion, there's no love, there's no softness. It's just. So what I would like to ask and hope and pray for each of you in this room is that you will go home today and throughout this next week as you're going to school or work or driving, that you will consider how the concept of the insufficiency of all things attainable applies to you. Are there things in your life that you're thinking, man, if I could just achieve that, if I could just accomplish that? I hope you do, certainly. But underneath that, if you're able to step back and go, but I know that that's not really going to, it's not going to do it. It's not going to satisfy. It's not going to fill that. It's not going to fit in that puzzle piece. It's not going to do it. Only one thing does. And some people can run from it their entire lives and resist and resist and resist. Maybe because they're afraid of it. You may know people in your life that call themselves Christians, right? Or go to church and they say they believe a certain thing, but they're mean or judgmental or harsh or unkind. And you're like, man, if that's, that's, I don't want that. There may be some bad representatives in your life, and I've certainly got hundreds of emails to prove that. Hundreds of emails from fans who will write me and talk about, share with me people in their lives, who blast them and rant and rave about things in the name of God. That's not what we're talking about here, you guys. We're talking about a relationship with him. And he is this close to you. He is right there. All you need to do, you don't have to fill out some form. You don't have to go to school, get a degree in theology. You don't have to attend a church for 12 consecutive Sundays. You don't have to cut your hair, change your clothes. You don't have to do anything but accept his gift of relationship through Jesus. That's all you have to do. A lot of people think it's bigger, more ominous than that. But that's the foundation of everything else. I would hope that for you. I'm not trying to convert you. I hope you don't get that. I hope you're not getting the sense that I'm trying to convert you to join anything. I want to challenge you to ask yourself these questions. And if anything I say resonates with you, you know what I mean by that? If I share something, or if you've heard something read today and something in you goes, whew, that's me. I can feel it. You know what I mean? And if it's only one of you, just one in this whole room, then this time was worth it. Mm-hmm. I would be remiss not to share it with you. I can't not share it. And the reason is because I believe it's good news. I believe that every one of you and me and even Aubrey, I love her. I believe that every one of you are desperately loved by God. You don't even know. You and I have a limited capacity to understand a lot of things. And one thing I don't think any of us can fully understand is how much God loves you. And the lengths that he will go to have a relationship with you if you're just open to it. There was a line in this book. One second, let me find it.
Pressure's on, right? You can never find it. There it is.
Thank you, Lord. What's it all for? In the end, longing and yearning are not really cyclists at all. They may be experienced as blind pressure, driving life to eat its way through drives, food, sex, friendship, creativity, but they are the Spirit of God groaning and praying through us. This is what the scripture is talking about when it tells us in Romans 8:26 that when we do not know how to pray, quote, the Spirit of God prays through us in groans too deep for words. In groans too deep for words. It's not even something you can define. That longing, that sense of restlessness. And the good news is that God understands that. You don't have to pray some fancy prayer. You don't have to put together some sequence of words in a particular order to unlock the next great level of the video game of God. He hears you. He hears your heart. I think that's about all I've got to say. And I hope that I didn't offend anybody. I get a little excited sometimes and intense, but it's me. I'm Italian, I'm gonna say. So I'm gonna close us in prayer. And I'm so glad that you guys came today. I hope I didn't scare anybody. But I do, in my heart, in my deepest place of my heart, believe that this is a wonderful, good thing, and it's a gift to anyone who's open to receiving it. I hope that's you. I don't know where you are in your life. Looking in your eyes right now. But I don't know. I can't see anything about your heartache, your loss, fears, guilt, challenges, hopes, dreams, apprehensions. But God does. And here's the good news. He loves you to death, all the same. There's nothing you can do about it. Isn't that good news? You know, you look around this room, every single human being in here, you could either make them your friend or make them your enemy, based on how you treat them, right? You could become friends with everybody in here, or you could tick people off and make them think you're a jerk and not want to be your friend, based on how you act, what you do or don't do, what you say or how you say it or what you don't say. And the best news of all is that God loves you just as you are, and nothing you can do or say will change that. That's really good news. Because you can't say that really about anybody else. Human beings, you know, our love and our friendship is pretty much conditional for the most part. There are some exceptions, but for the most part, people want to be your friend if you're nice to them. If you're not, they really don't want to be your friend. And on any given day, we all say dumb things, behave in ways we regret. But God knows you better than anybody knows you, and He loves you more than anybody loves you. And that's an amazingly comforting and good news. I hope you feel that. I hope you'll open yourself up to be willing to feel that. Because it is certainly there. Okay, let's close in prayer. Thank you for this morning, Father. Thank you for every single person that came today. I don't know how many of them, this is the first time they've ever come to one of these Sunday morning events, but I'm so grateful that they did. They may not even know why they came. And I've never read anything out of some book like this before. And I hope it was the right choice, and I hope that you will use what was written on these pages and what I read to connect with someone here. I pray that each of us will leave here today knowing deep in our souls that we have a God-shaped hole in our hearts and everything attainable is insufficient to filling that space. It is created and designed only for you. And if anyone in here does not have that relationship and has not yet opened themselves to that relationship with you through Jesus, I pray that they would do that today, tomorrow, as soon as possible, because there is an amazing relationship just waiting for them. Thank you for the privilege to share, and that these people would give me this amount of their time to share this with them. I'm so grateful for the privilege to speak with them, Lord. I pray that you would give everyone here a good day. I pray that they would smile big and share love and kindness and joy with those around them today. Make the space that they move in a better place. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys for coming. What's today? There is a wedding today. Is it in this room?